Good afternoon. This is our last lecture. So, the recapitulation of what we did last time. So, these were equations of motion of a charged particle within an external electromagnetic field. Electromagnetic field is represented by what we have named phi mu nu, which represent both electric and magnetic field, and the particle is written as a one parameter family x mu of t. Yeah? So this is just a curve in space-time. Non-relativistic theory, Maxwell theory, was the following: m x dot equal f, and in the case of electromagnetic forces, those f was electric charge multiplied by electric field, and at the end of 19th century people realized that also magnetic field acts on a charged particle, but the force is perpendicular to the motion, and this is called Lorentz force. So these are non-relativistic equations of motion. Now, what is the derivative with respect to what? To the absolute time. Now we don't have absolute time. Therefore, to write down dx mu over dt, where t is nothing by x0, is not a nice object, because the first component is surely 1, because dx0 over dx0 is 1, whereas the last space-time components are precisely this non-relativistic velocity. But this object I have called v mu, but it is not interesting because, it is not very interesting, it is interesting a bit, but it has a fundamental drawback, namely that it depends upon the parameter which stands here, and the time is no longer absolute. Therefore, instead of that, we prefer to take dx mu over ds, and this quantity I have called x mu, where s is internal time. Yeah? So for instance, if we are traveling in a spaceship far away from our Earth, so this s is responsible for our age. We feel that every year we are older and older and older, and this is our proper time. Whereas this time depends upon the choice of coordinates, but this is nothing especially interesting. And this is nothing but just this quantity v mu, but divided by the length of v, which is simply the normalized velocity. The normalized velocity. Yeah? So the difference in non-relativist, in Euclidean geometry is, suppose you have a curve which is, for example, a road on a map. So dxk over dt is velocity. However, dxk over length is a vector which is unit, yeah? Because this tells me how the first coordinate grows per 1 meter of the length, how the second and how the fourth, and we know that the sum of squares of this object is exactly one, because this will be, yeah, you understand. Why? Because we take the derivative, square, the sum of x equal 1 to 3 is 1. Obvious? Of course, because dx1 square plus dx2 square plus dx3 square is dl square. Therefore, after all, this is dl square divided by dl square, and this is 1. And the same here. If I take the derivative with respect to any parameter, I get anything I wish. In principle, if t is just x0, this choice, among all others, is characterized by the fact that there is normalization of the first component, whereas if I use the proper time, which means the four-dimensional distance, which is covered by this particle which moves, then automatically this velocity is normalized, like there in Euclidean geometry. Okay, so the lesson is never take derivatives with respect to laboratory time, because this does not correspond to any real physical law which applies to our physical system, because it applies not only to our system but also to the reference frame. But we want to have physical laws which do not depend upon the choice of reference frame. Yeah? Okay. Which means that instead of x dot, we will have this u mu. Yeah? This was three-dimensional in physics because time was something absolute. Now it is four-dimensional. In why was it three-dimensional? Because this one, you may forget about it. One is one. What is interesting here? Only three components. Yeah? But now we have four components. This is not a trivial, but again, only three components are non-trivial because we know that this is normalized. So the number of independent informations is the same here and there. Okay, now, what about acceleration? Again, it is forbidden to take the acceleration is a derivative of the velocity with respect to time. But again, it is forbidden to take external time, laboratory time, because it depends upon the choice of the laboratory. And we don't want to formulate laws concerning laboratory, but concerning only this particle which moves, and this particle does not know from which laboratory it is observed. Yeah? Therefore, again, don't take derivative with respect to laboratory time, but always with respect to s. Yeah. Therefore, acceleration, which we have, is nothing but d over ds again of this u mu. And because u mu has the length, which is constant, it doesn't change, as a consequence, this is orthogonal. Orthogonal in this pseudo Riemannian or pseudo Euclidean sense, it is orthogonal. A is orthogonal to U in the following sense, that A mu G mu nu U nu, which we may also write as A scalar product with U, is always zero. Why? I have proved it. Yeah? Why? Because U has constant length. So if it has a constant length, it can move only in the direction which is orthogonal. Yeah? Because if it changes the length, it moves in the direction of u. Whereas if it does not change, if I have a vector which may move, but only in such a way that its length does not change,